Good evening, everyone. So tonight we are going to wrap up our study on the history of the church. How many years did we cover? So far we've covered about 1500 years. We should be able to cover another 500 years, no problem tonight, okay? So by tonight, we have covered about 2000 years of church history. Praise God. Anyway, the last two or three meetings, we went through the history of the church, and I'm sure you have found out that our past has been so disconcerting, to say the least, very appalling. And I think what we can identify as the main cause for what the dark ages of the church and the other problems that the church encountered is the church being entrenched with secular rulers. I think that's the root cause. We discussed that last time, what you would consider as the root cause. Anyway, we went through a lot and the church has survived. And as the prayer of our sister Gurley, according to the prayer that she has recited for us, it is indeed very comforting that our Lord Jesus Christ, true to his promise, has sent the Holy Spirit and has always been with the church since then. So this is one thing we should realize. While God's revelation and the truth that God has handed down to us through his apostles can be compared to what I call a solid bar of pure gold, it cannot be permeated by any kind of dirt. It's solid. The fact is, this solid pure bar of gold has passed to so many dirty hands, especially those who were secular in their formation. But despite all of that, this pure bar of gold has never been tarnished. That is all that matters. What matters is that God's revelation has been kept intact. It has not been affected at all by the rough ride that it went through for so many, many, many years. Okay. But one thing about all of these things that the church went through, the rough sailing, especially during the Protestant Reformation, we have one outstanding positive result. We really realize the need for reform and renewal. Now we are going to take up the Catholic Reformation, because the Protestant Reformation has actually invited a reformation of the church, but the true reformation of the church without in any way touching any of the truth that Jesus Christ has handed down to us. So we will look through tonight, what are those different stages of reformation that we have been going through? And we realize that despite the Catholic Reformation, it was just started right after the Protestant Reformation, and the purification of the church is ongoing. So we will go through now the rest of the history of the church and find out for ourselves how the purification of the church is actually been taking place. Well, the problems that we have right now, presently, pales in comparison, of course, to what we have been through. In the past, it was almost insurmountable. Now the problem that we have is basically zeroing in on sexual abuse of the clergy people, the sexual scandal in the church. We will take that up also tonight. Okay? So let's look at the very first step that the church took in order to bring about real reformation of the church without touching, without changing the truth of God's revelation. Let's go to the next slide now. The church called the Council of Trent, a very important council in 1545. What did the Council of Trent do? It suppressed all forms of abuses. It tried to correct all those abuses in the church. It did not change any doctrine. Let's keep that in mind. The doctrine of the church cannot change. The tone by which we deliver the doctrine can change. Our understanding of the doctrine of the church can develop, can deepen, but none of the doctrines of the church can ever change, because God is the same today, yesterday, and forever. And the truth of God's revelation is the word of God, who is God himself. God cannot change. So what did the Council of Trent do? It simply clarified all those doctrines that were challenged during the Protestant Reformation, including the doctrine of the church on purgatory and indulgence. We did not, and the Council of Trent did not in any way introduce any changes on this doctrine, but took more steps to make sure that it is more clearly understood by us. And very important, it tightened discipline in the church. Right after the Council of Trent, they established a real effective seminary system for the training of those who would like to be part of the clergy. All right. Then the next step that happened, next slide, was the invalidation of scandalous indulgences. Let me read the decree issued by St. Pius V in 1567. The decree reads, it permanently revoke, void, invalidate, and annul, and render profitless each and every indulgence for the gaining of which an alms must be offered, and contains in any way permission to make collections. So those indulgences that were sold without the authority of the church never authorized the selling of indulgences. Let's keep this in mind. The church never authorized the selling of indulgences. But it was abuse, because these people who bought themselves into the clergy started selling indulgences. That's why now in this decree, all of those indulgences were invalidated. And as a matter of fact, since then up to the present, the church has not in any way again ever issued indulgences in exchange for any contribution to the church. Right? That's one big reform that we have. And then next slide. As always, God raised great saints in the church. If you can read the lives of Francis Xavier, Therese of Avila, John of the Cross, Ignatius of Loyola, you will see that all these men that were raised by God during all these problems that the church has been besieged with have really contributed a lot to the purification of the church. So now we will get into the 17th and the 18th century. Next slide. The Age of Enlightenment. In the 17th and 18th century, there was a surge of knowledge, like the surge of technology that we're having now. In the 17th and 18th century, people became very much into the advancement of their knowledge of science, technology, and philosophy. Next slide. However, this is a problem now because of so much absorption into the pursuit of science, technology, and philosophy. It got into this scientist's head, this technologist's head, this philosopher's head, that they thought everything that cannot be explained, that cannot be grasped by the human mind, should be dismissed. That the human mind has all the capability to appreciate the wholeness of one's life and the philosophy of the way they live their lives. So they promoted a different understanding of religion. But first of all, let's look into, I'm sure you must have heard about Galileo Galilei. Galileo Galilei was a scientist, astronomer, and he discovered one thing that has been taught by the church in matters of science. Take note of that right off the bat. Whenever the church ventures into a field that is beyond its competence, it can definitely be in error. The infallibility promised by Jesus Christ to the Holy Spirit is limited to only matters of faith and morals. In matters of science, the church can be wrong, and the church has been dead wrong. In matters of politics, the church can be wrong, and the church has been dead wrong, depending on whose side you are with. So the church should never venture in matters into which it has no competence whatsoever, and into which Jesus Christ has not extended the protection of infallibility. So, during the time of Galileo Galilei, he discovered, contrary to what the church has been teaching, that the earth is not the center of the universe. The earth is just a speck in the universe, and that the sun does not revolve around the earth, but rather the earth revolves around the sun. So that kind of discovery by Galileo has put into question what the church has always thought in matters of science. The church was dead wrong. Because at that time, the church has not yet developed any understanding of the seeming conflict between science and the teaching of the Bible. We tended likewise to interpret the Bible literally until lately we have discovered that the Bible is not to be taken literally. Otherwise, we will all be dragged down by discussions like, was the world created in 7 days, really? Or was there really an Adam and Eve in the sense that they are not really representational of humanity? Are they real persons? Are they, all of these things we never really appreciated because we tended then at that time to interpret scripture literally or literalistically. Even. Okay, so the church did not have the competence to make any explanation of any scientific phenomena. Okay, so we did not appreciate the difference between scientific explanation of scientific phenomena and scientific and explanation of their religious truth. So, because of such incompetence, the church was shocked by the discovery of Galileo Galilei and took steps to stop him from promoting that idea. As a matter of fact, he was charged with heresy and he was tried in Rome in 1633. And it was only his public renunciation or recantation of his opinion that avoided him the death penalty. Would you believe that? Because the church still at that particular point in time has not really divorced itself from the control of civic authorities, which mete out penalties. So Galileo Galilei was sentenced to lifetime house arrest. Not in prison, he was never in prison. He was on house arrest for the rest of his life, okay? Now, we should understand also that on October 31st, 1992, Pope John Paul II acknowledged that the church erred in condemning Galilei. So we are honest enough to admit that we made a mistake. The church made a mistake. Don't be scandalized. The church would always make a mistake, as I already brought up. It will always be, the church will always be mistaken if it tries to get into the field outside its competence. All right, so that's the scandal that happened during the search of science and technology in the 17th and 18th century. Next thing that happened, next slide, was the French Revolution of 1789. Wow. This is very important because during the French Revolution, they took all steps to abolish Christianity and to promote soul reliance on reason. During the French Revolution, it was proposed that it was already time to throw off the charms of religion, that religion is the source of intellectual darkness and that it is an obstacle to the pursuit of intellect. So that was the main theme that they promoted. They wanted to abolish any form of religion, as a matter of fact, and promoted atheism, which they call, this is the religion of reason. We have all the capacity to understand everything. And if we cannot understand it, it should be dismissed. That's the greatest problem that the church confronted with during the French Revolution. And in that revolution, the church properties were seized. The papal estates was practically taken over. So the church lost a lot of properties during the 18th century, especially during the French Revolution. Now, the next thing now we go to is the 19th century. Next slide. 19th century. We're like hopping here from one century to another. The rise of representative government. Then we started understanding that totalitarian government is always not representative of the people that they rule. And it's certainly dictatorial. So we tried to experiment on various forms of government. And the best thing that happened was, on the next slide we will see, the end, finally, next slide, the end of monarchy the end of the union of church and state. The union of church and state is, I would say, the mother of all the corruptions in the church. Because when the church and state are working together, the civil rulers who does not, most of whom did not have any sense of spirituality, would also be ruling the church. And that really ruined the state of the church. But thank God, towards the 19th century, one by one, monarchy and the union of church and state was disintegrated. Okay? And that stopped greatly and curbed the secularization of the church. Up to now, we have some monarchical government, but actually they're ceremonial, really. Not really anymore running the government, like the monarchy, the Queen of England, its position is simply ceremonial. Most monarchical institutions now are ceremonial. They are not really involved in the running of the government. Then let's get to the council that was called the First Vatican Council. Next slide. That was in from 1869 to 1870, the First Vatican Council. It happened and it started in December 8, 1869 and ended on October 20, 1870. What was achieved during this council? Very, very important that the church was able to put forth the proposition that faith has primacy over reason. We were made to realize that no matter how smart we think we are, being mere finite beings, we are subject to limitations. And so, next slide, Pope Pius IX, who was then presiding the First Vatican Council, reminded the Church of the primacy of faith over reason and came up with the syllabus of errors, basically and essentially stressing the errors on sole reliance of the human mind. And by the way, Pope Pius IX is also referred to as the last king pope, because he was still considered a civil ruler at the same time. Okay, that so he is being referred to as the last king pope. And it is during this Vatican Council that the teaching of papal infallibility was dogmatically defined. Next slide. Take note. Teaching of papal infallibility. Let's understand, papal infallibility was not something that was invented or as part of the teaching only during the First Vatican Council. It has always been understood by the early church, by the early fathers of the church, that the Holy Spirit has been promised by our Lord Jesus Christ to protect the apostles and their successors from committing any error that would ruin the revelation of Jesus Christ, to make sure that God's revelation is kept pure, unadulterated, not diluted in any way. Jesus Christ, I think we took that out, promised over and over during the Last Supper that the Holy Spirit will protect them from committing errors. That is what infallibility is all about. It was only dogmatically defined during the First Vatican Council, but it has always been in place as God's promise of protection from error from the very beginning. Just let's review that a little bit. In Luke chapter 10, verse 16, the scripture says that Jesus Christ told his apostles, gave them a full authority that if people listen to them, then they are actually listening to him. Whoever listens to you, listens to me. Whoever rejects you, rejects me. And if they reject me, they reject the one that who sent me. That's in Luke chapter 10, verse 16. That is one of the biblical basis for the protection of infallibility from the Holy Spirit. And of course, we've taken up Matthew chapter 16. Thou art Peter, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of the nether world will not prevail against it. We've learned that the gates of the nether world is that force that tries to destroy God's revelation. It will never prevail against the church. We have seen in John chapter 21, verses 15 to 17, that Jesus instituted Peter, the person of Peter, as the shepherd of the church when he said, feed my lamb, feed my sheep, feed my flock. In Luke chapter 22, verse 32, all of these are supporting the teaching of infallibility, meaning protection of the Holy Spirit. He said Jesus Christ prayed specifically for Peter, despite the fact that he was with his other apostles. And then he said, I pray for you, Peter, so that you in turn can strengthen your brothers. In John chapter 16, verse 13, he promised during the Last Supper that the Holy Spirit will guide you into all truth. When the Holy Spirit guides you into all truth, the Holy Spirit will not lead you to error. So all of these biblical passages that I just mentioned to you are basis of the teaching of infallibility. What happened in 1878 is simply to define it dogmatically so that there will no longer be any doubt about the fact that Jesus has promised that the Holy Spirit will be sent to them to protect them from committing any error. Of course, the error against which they will be protected would have to pertain only to matters of faith and morals, because it is only the matters of faith and morals that are relevant, that are part of God's revelation. So God's revelation is completely preserved. That is what infallibility is all about. It has nothing to do with the constitutional accuracy of the mind of the Pope. Oh, Peter was just a fisherman, as you know. It has nothing to do with that. Infallibility is all about the Holy Spirit protecting them. Right? So that was made very clear in this in the First Vatican Council, when this was dogmatically defined. Now, next slide, the rise of, we have all this kind of ideology that dismisses our faith in God. The rise of fascism, Nazism, communism, all of whom practically promoted atheism. They dismissed the faith as simply the opiate of the masses. That is very hard to deal with. And they were the ones trying to rule the world in the 20th century. You know what happened during the time of Hitler, during the time of Mussolini. all of this, but the church again was able to survive. Now let's go to the next slide. During the reign of St. Pius X, in all his teachings, vigorously opposed any form of atheism. And he is the one who codified the church, all the church laws, into what we call now the canon law, right? Next slide. Then the World War broke out. World War I. From 1914 to 1918, 4 years. Pope Benedict the 15th reigned at that time, was the reigning pope at that time. He maintained strict neutrality of the church. The church did not take any side, but did everything it could in order to reconcile the warring parties. Okay, so the pontificate of Pope Benedict the 15th was largely overshadowed by the war. And then from 1922 to 1937, Pope Pius XI was the reigning pope, during which he established the Feast of Christ the King. We just celebrated the Feast of Christ the King, I think just couple of weeks ago, October 25. One of the reasons why he established that is to remind everyone that the kingdom of God is a spiritual kingdom. And the king of this kingdom is Jesus Christ himself. That was the reason for having this feast of Christ the King, a reminder to all of us that Christ reigns the whole world. Not the political world, but the spiritual world, the universal spiritual world. And Pope Pius XI condemned communism in 1937. Next slide. We go to the surrender of the Papal States. As you know, during the Second World War, Mussolini took over the whole of Italy, and you know that Rome is part of Italy. It's in fact the capital of Italy. And at that time, the church has so much vast properties all throughout Italy, despite the fact that many of them were already seized during the French Revolution. But there were still many of them throughout Italy. But when Mussolini took over, he wanted to seize all the properties of the church. So the church had to negotiate with Mussolini until finally Pope Pius XI was able to convince Mussolini to let the church just take hold of 100 acres of land. That's not very big, isn't it? Probably just the whole of Cirino, so not even the whole of Cirino, okay? And they signed the Lateran Treaty in 1922 in exchange of what? Very important, the independence of the church from any civil ruler and the sovereignty of the church. At least now we all know that Vatican City is not just a city, it is a sovereign state. That's why Vatican City has ambassadors to practically all sovereign states in the world. It is an independent country, Vatican City, just 109 acres. And of course, Mussolini guaranteed the church of dominion in spiritual matters and not to be interfered with in spiritual matters. And that the church would always be free of the dominion of temporal powers. And the church finally was able to focus more on its spiritual mission, on its spiritual authority. So the church is being purified. The church has surrendered all material possessions practically to Mussolini. And it bode well for the church because it was able to focus on the mission of the church. Then we go to the next war that happened, of course, World War II. Next slide. From 1939 to 1945, the World War II was waged all throughout the world. And this was during the reign of Pope Pius XII. Pope Pius XII continued the policy of neutrality, but he has been very strongly criticized by the Christian world because he sort of kept quiet and decided that instead of rhetorics, he would not condemn, Hitler, he would not condemn all the other powers, but would just focus himself to helping the Jews in Italy and elsewhere. You know, during the time of the Second World War, he was feeding at least about 300,000 Jews. He was hiding them. He was feeding them every single day. Okay, and so he was criticized for that because he did not expressly condemn communism or Hitler, because he wanted to avoid more reprisal of the people of God. Okay? He was really widely criticized for that. But he focused on the right thing. He focused on helping those victims of war. And you know what? This thing that he has done was recognized by Israel after the war. He was given a special award for helping the Jews during the Second World War. So despite all this criticism against him, it cannot be denied that he has done so well for the church. But after the war, he excommunicated all Catholics belonging to the Communist Party. So that's the legacy of Pope Pius XII to us. Next slide. Then we call, the church called the Second Vatican Council. Started on October 11, 1962. Most of us remember that. And it lasted up to December 8, 1965. And who was the Pope that called the Second Vatican Council? Next slide. The good Pope. The good Pope. Pope John the 23rd. He called the Second Vatican Council seeking the unity of the Christians through ecumenism. He was aiming to bring the church to the people. And so one of the main things that it immediately embarked into is to get into our overhauling of our liturgy, the liturgical reforms. That was the only time that the Mass started to be celebrated in the language of the people. Before that, I think many of us have experienced that. The Mass was being said in Latin. And who was understanding that? What's going on? What's going on during the Mass? I was an altar boy then. I have memorized all those confiteor in Latin at that time, but I did not understand a word I was reciting in prayer. And that's how people was, and rightfully so. Pope John the 23rd saw the need to bring the people, the church to the people by, number one, introducing a liturgy that would be understood by the people. So it was, the Mass since then is being said in the people's language, even in their vernacular, okay? All right, so, and then he called for a new Pentecost. You know the charismatic movement? It, I think, started sometime after this. Even in the Catholic Church, when Pope John Paul II prayed for the renewal of Pentecost in our time. Let us experience the fire of the Holy Spirit descending on us by igniting us in our spiritual life. And that brought about a lot in bringing the purification of the church. The next Pope now. As you know, Pope, next slide. The next Pope we had was Pope Paul VI. Pope John the 23rd died sometime in 1963. And Pope Paul VI took over. The Second Vatican Council was not yet completed at that time. It's Pope Paul VI who completed the Second Vatican Council. After the Second Vatican Council was completed, he realized that the church this time is being flooded with irresponsible experimentation of what ecumenism means. People thought that the church is now adapting itself to the modern ways of thinking, that the church is accommodating its doctrines, its teachings to the modern ways and thoughts. For instance, they're saying, why does still the church limit living together of people in love in marriage? Why can't they get into what was popular? Popularized. Why cannot they get into a trial marriage so that there will be less failure in marriages? So they thought that that was the Second Vatican Council is all about. That anything that is considered outdated or taboo would no longer be part of the church. But no, the church would not allow any adjustment to the modern ways of the secular world. So the church held on. As I said, all the teachings of the church can never change. None of them will ever change. They will simply evolve, but not change. I think we have understood that very well. It comes from a seed that will grow into a huge plant, a huge tree, but still from the same seed. The seed has not changed, right? Okay, so we go to the next Pope, Pope John Paul II. I believe Pope John Paul II is one of the most loved Pope. Next slide. Pope John Paul II, he reigned from 1978 to 2005. He actually succeeded Pope John Paul I. You remember Pope John Paul I? He became Pope for only 33 days. And I think he had a heart attack. I'm not so sure. But after 33 days, he died. And so there was again another election. And it was Pope John Paul II that was elected. And what is the most important legacy of Pope John Paul II. Next slide. Let's look at this. A call for purification. Call for purification. First, he asked the church to repent. Because there cannot be an amendment of life without repentance. To repent for the error and beg for forgiveness for the mistakes that the church committed in the past. He begged forgiveness for the religious wars waged by the crusaders on behalf of the church. He begged forgiveness for the Inquisition. All of those really soiled the image of the church, to say the least. The condemnation of Galileo, he said, we made a mistake. We should never have condemned Galileo. Okay. Never again will the church teach on science. Never again will the church venture into any field that is beyond faith and knowledge. That was the call for purification. Let us focus on our role as the guide, the shepherd of God's people. Okay. Now, that was the legacy of Pope John Paul II. Let me read to you the tribute of Billy Graham on Pope John Paul II. Billy Graham was really impressed with Pope John Paul II. In Life magazine, Billy Graham was the one who prepared this tribute. And let me just read to you one paragraph on what he said. When future historians look back on the most influential personalities of the 20th century, the name of Pope John Paul II will unquestionably loom large in their accounts. Few individuals have had a greater impact, not just religiously, but socially and morally, on the modern world. He will stand as the most influential moral voice of our time. What a great tribute that Billy Graham paid to him. All right. Pope John Paul II was also responsible in giving to us the Catechism of the Catholic Church. There you go, Catechism of the Catholic Church. Because this really helped the church a lot in guiding us, in understanding our faith. That's why I encourage all of you here to make sure that you own the copy of the Catechism of the Catholic Church, because you will no longer just be guessing what the church teaches on any important issues. It's right there. It's clearly defined. In paragraph 11, the Catechism reads that the Catechism aims at presenting an organic synthesis of the essential and fundamental contents of the Catholic doctrine as regards both faith and morals. In the light of the Second Vatican Council and the whole of the Church tradition, its principal sources are the sacred scriptures. So don't ever think that the Catholic Church is not a lover of the Bible. We put together the Bible. We gave the Bible to the world. We canonized the Bible. So all teachings of the church, Catholic Church, cannot, if you just really try to understand it as much, cannot and has never contradicted anything in scripture. The fathers of the church, of course, the apostolic tradition, the church magisterium, it is intended to serve as a point of reference for the catechisms or compendia that are composed in various countries, because before we have varied catechism, now we were able to put them all together into one compendium of catechism. So that's again another legacy that he gave us. And of course, he had this tirade against the culture of that. He was very much involved in the culture of death that was creeping into our society in the late 70s and the early 21st century. Okay. Then let's go to the next pope. We're almost there. We're almost done. Benedict the 16th. Pope Benedict the 16th. Next slide. And he reigned from 2005 to 2013. He resigned because of his health, according to me, and because I think he was very much, beset by so many controversies that was raging on during his time, especially the sex scandal in the church. He, next slide, His legacy to us is his tirade against relativism, moral relativism. So he came up with this book, The Dictatorship of Relativism. He believes that moral relativism is the core challenge facing the church today, that there is no longer any absolute when it comes to morality. He specifically stressed that that is one of the core challenge of the church, that the church is facing. After he resigned, who was elected? Our present Pope. Pope, next slide. Pope Francis. When did Pope Francis get elected? 2013, up to the present, he is our Pope. Let's talk about Pope Francis this time. Next slide. Let's see, he was chosen as the person of the year. Next slide, in 2013. And I read through this, the tribute to Pope Francis in Time Magazine. Remember, Time Magazine is not a religious magazine. It's a secular magazine. But they are all praises for Pope Francis. They pointed out that Pope Francis is really the model of austerity. You know, Pope Francis was not living in the Vatican Palace, no. He's just living in a small house in Vatican. He refused to live in the Vatican Palace, where all the other popes have resided during their reign, okay? And when he was the Archbishop of Argentina, he was riding a bus. And he would just stay in an apartment and paid for his apartment. If he would go to any, check into in any hotel, he would personally pay for the hotel bills himself. So he was a model of austerity. His theology is formed by his commitment to the poor. The Time Magazine has noted that he has a sincere and committed love for the poor and the marginalized. You know, whenever he received gifts, you know, when you hold that position, you cannot avoid getting gifts from several people, and they are expensive gifts. You know what he would always do? He would sell them, and the proceeds he would distribute to the poor. So he owns nothing for himself. The central theme of his papacy, a welcoming church. I'd like to read this beautiful quotation from him. I prefer a church that is bruised, hurting, and dirty because it has been out on the streets, rather than a church which is unhealthy from being confined and from clinging to its own security. What is he saying? We are meant for the world. Get out there. Reach out. Okay. And then he was unwilling to pass moral judgment. The very famous quotation, if a person is gay and seeks God and has good will, who am I to judge? Remember that? He said that when he was interviewed in play. Because we already know too that the church is never in the business of judging. Its main role is guiding, shepherding, not judging people. Only God can judge, but it can guide people. In fact, his statement about these homosexuals is consistent with what we already took up the last time, paragraph 847. If a person nevertheless seek God with sincere heart and move by grace, try in their actions to do his will, as they know it, to the dictates of their conscience, those two may achieve eternal salvation. So, Pope, make no mistake about it, Pope Francis is not a radical Pope. He was not changing any doctrine. What is he doing? He is simply changing its tune. This is what he is doing. He is delivering the pure bar of gold, the revelation, the truth of God, packaged in love and wrapped in compassion for the poor, reaching out to the marginalized. Because an entry point in any spirituality, he understands it, is love. That is the main entry point. You cannot bring about evangelization of anyone if they cannot sense that you truly love them, that you truly care for them, that you are compassionate, that you are kind. Therefore, legalism has no place in the church. Being literal and judgmental has no place in the church. Wonderful. So whenever you hear anything about Pope Francis, check it out. Try to find out what was the underlying philosophy about all this statement. It's the underlying philosophy of love and compassion. All right, next slide.